Mehdi
man.
Adesmith, my brother. How you doing?
Good, you.
Good, good. Bro, before we start, let me just take a half a second to introduce you to my audience. Mehdi
Yes.
Adesmith is a superstar, ex-professional football player in the NFL, played with the Tennessee Titans as well as the Tampa Bay Buccaneers, which last year they won the Super Bowl, so that's pretty dope. And the man right now is becoming a real estate broker. So Mehdi, such a blessing for us to have you on the show today. Thank you very
Thank you
much
for
for
having
showing
me.
up. My pleasure. And let me just introduce myself to your community. My name is Christopher Dedden. I am a professional speaker and peak performance coach. So my brother, how are you doing today, bro?
I'm doing well. You?
I am blessed,
I
man.
love your energy, man. It's contagious, when you speak with someone, big smile, juice, you get hyped too.
Bro, honestly, there's no other way. There's no other
Yeah.
way. I really appreciate that. And this is something that in basic comes natural to me, but I definitely do develop it because, like you said, it is contagious. The more you smile, the more receptors sent to your brain, the like happy energy just comes about and it's just attractive. So I really
Yep.
appreciate that, brother. So,
Thank
man,
you.
there's so many things that I want to talk about. I've had other professional athletes that are currently doing it. I recently had Ayman Zahabi, a UFC fighter. You're my
Nice.
first retired athlete that's on the show, and I want to ask right off the bat, was it difficult leaving the NFL, but not only leaving the NFL, but kind of putting that cross on the ideology that I am no longer a professional football player? Because your whole life, I'm sure you attest or you were that mindset of that I am a football player. And once that's taken away, how did you feel? Is there really that dip that professional athletes feel? How did you feel about that?
I mean, it's pretty hard because, playing football, I used to play football since I was 9 years old. So during my whole life, I was surrounded by sports, so I was surrounded by coaches. I was surrounded by teammates. I was in the locker room, you spending so much time with your teammates, having fun, you spend more time just chilling with your boys, just hanging out with them and building connections. So, and then when I went to playing pros, I was in the league for like a year and a half. Let's say at my second season, I got released and I got hurt. But the thing was, I didn't stop playing because I didn't like it no more. I stopped playing because my body was hurting. So playing football, I kind of lost the joy of playing because when I was stepping on the field, I was always hurt. I was okay, my back is sore, my knees are banged up. I tore my patellar tendon when I was in college in 2013. So following that, I was always getting banged up. And so that's what happened. After that, I was, I kind of lost the joy of playing the sport because I was not at my peak performance. And when I was watching me play, I was like, man, I'm losing something, but I was still able to play because I was still playing. But so that was a big decision for me because when I got back home, I got back in 2017. I spent some time with my family. I'm a big family guy. I love my mother. I love my sisters. I'm really close to them. Since my dad passed away when I was young, we really got close. And so I needed to come back. So I came back and I started working for Ubisoft. And after 5 months, then the Giants called me and they were like, okay, we want you to come to our training camp. And that was the decision when I said, when I said no. I didn't want to go back there and being kind of a journeyman going from team to team, and doing that. So I was like, you know what? I'm good home. I got a degree in finance, a master into administration. I'm just gonna build off that. I build up all the work ethic with football and I'm just gonna take it from there. So to answer your question, I miss it. I miss being around my teammate. I miss being, just making a big sack and having the whole crowd, like 80,000 people just cheering and get hyped. That's not something that you can do now. You cannot sell a house and just go on the front yard and be like, yeah, I did it. But that's something that I missed, but I got into CrossFit. So that's why I got into CrossFit and we can talk about that later on.
Yo, Mehdi, first and foremost, brother, thank you for all of that information. We're gonna unpack it. But who says you can't do that? Yeah, I got it when you sell a house. That could be your marketing. That could be your marketing, where every time you sell a house, get a football and just snap it on the floor and be like, yeah, Mehdi sold one. But brother, let me just highlight a couple of things because there's so many things that you mentioned that were just so interesting that I think our listeners have to kind of dive into. That awareness of understanding of where you are within the journey of your professional football career and understanding of like, hey, do I want to continue this or not? It comes down to awareness. And anybody that wants to be successful in life, you have to have self-awareness at such a high level. So congratulations for being there because, like you said, it's not easy turning down an offer from the Giants to be like, hey, come train with us and potentially get a spot on the roster. And you're obviously capable of doing it. You've been on two different teams as well. So, man, that is amazing. And as we continue on this thread, tell me, as actually Aboudi said he's the best football player in Laval, which is the greater region of Montreal. I 100%
Thank
agree. Unless there's other football players, I know that that's true. But here's my question. Let's talk about the come up, because to be a professional athlete in itself is almost impossible. Like the statistics are against you. To be an NFL player, even more. Like, you know how many players get pumped out in the schooling system of the States and so on and so forth. And you're a dude from Montreal. Now, slowly more and more, there's Canadians coming into the NFL, which is amazing and super blessed about that. But let's talk about that journey. Was it difficult getting there? Were you always like pushed aside because you're Canadian? Is there like a just a position on that aspect, or they kind of open you with open arms? How did you get into the NFL, especially being Canadian?
No, I kind of believe that I'm built for this grind, you know. So, you know, since I'm young, you know, I was 9 years old. I was playing with guys that were older than me because in the system, when you play for your city, it goes with your weight. So I used to be chubby, you know, I was fat. So I was playing with guys that was really older and I was getting smacked. But that kind of built my mentality of, you know, okay, just get back up and get back to work. And at some point, that's where I took, you know, the next step. And I started believing in myself, you know, that I could go far already when I start playing for Les Loups de Curé Antoine Labelle. That's when I really saw that I had potential. You know, I was like, okay, I can't make it because, you know, if I'm always, let's say that, if I'm always the best on my team, I can go to the next step. You know, I can go to the next level. So I made Team Quebec, I made Team Canada and Team World. And when I was in high school, my dad passed away. I was 16, and that's the moment that, you know, I took, you know, I became a man at that time, you know, because you can take two paths. You can take one path that you're gonna go and just cry and be like, oh, my dad passed away, I'm sad, there is no man figure in my life no more. Or you can take the path of, okay, you see what your dad went through. My dad went through three brain surgery and he fought for us. I saw my mom really working hard and I was, you know, I gotta make it for them, you know, so I'm gonna put everything that I have to go as far as possible. So I'm not gonna listen to nobody that's gonna tell me, hey, it's not possible. You cannot make it to the NFL. You cannot make it to the NCAA. It's not possible, man. You like one guy into the whole country and they have like players, like you said, getting pumped off of high school, you know. So I was like, you know, I'm gonna make it. I don't care. I'm gonna find a way. So after that, I went for les Spartiates du Cégep du Vieux-Montréal. I played there 2 years. Then I got an offer from Better University, and I decided to come back to Montreal to get more offers. And that's when all the offers came back. You know, at that time, we didn't have no internet, like YouTube was not really developed like that. So I used to make a highlight tape on a CD, on a disc, and I send it to, you know, schools. Just I maybe at the smart from Montreal, and they watch my tape. If they like me, then they contact me. And that's how I got my offers. Boston College came to my house twice. They told me that they wanted me. Boston College was the best fit for me because it was school first, and they were also playing in the ACC, which is one of the best conference into the NCAA. So I was okay, that's the best fit for me. It's close to home, so my family can drive 6 hours, 6, 7, and come see me. So I decided to go there, and then from there too, I was okay, I'm in the NCAA now. I'm in the ACC. Why not me? You know, why not me? You know, so I worked my butt off. 2013, I was supposed to be a top rounder getting picked. I blew my patella tendon, dislocated my patella too. So even there, people was saying, Mehdi, man, it's not possible. You know, you're having a career-ending injury. It's over for you. And I blocked the noise. I had one surgery in 2013, tried to come back in 2014, didn't do it because my knee wasn't fine. So I had another knee surgery in 2014. So I missed two football season. At that point, who's going to think that you're going to make it to the league? You know, at that point, I was like, if nobody's going to believe it, it's, you know, it's me. So 2015 had a great year. I had like 15 TFL, which is tackle for loss. I had like six sacks. I was in an all-star team too and got invited to the NFL Combine, the first guy from Quebec to get the invite there. And then I got picked up by the Tennessee Titans. So that was my road, you know. Like I said, you know, I'm built for the grind. I'm not scared. So I just, you know, put the work in, you know, if God, you know, I'm a big believer in God. If it's made for you and you put the work in, you will get it.
Yo. Mehdi, listen, I'm going to be real with you. I was getting goosebumps through your story, and I'm not blowing steam off your butt, bro. This is legit, and here's why. First and foremost, brother, my condolences for your father.
Thank you.
But that understanding that you had of like, hey, my father is no longer here. I have to play the role of the male figure. I lost the role of male figure, but I still have my mom, which is beautiful, powerful. I have my sisters and so on and so forth. And you were able to utilize that as a positive energy towards your goal. And then going through the struggles, not being drafted, getting picked up by Tennessee. I mean, brother, man, hats off. That is amazing. And as well, you said that you started with the high school with the Lelou. There's a bunch of people in the chats that are like, Lelou, Lelou. And I'm actually... played football against you guys. I was actually a quarterback in my high school team, Vanguard, a smaller team. But yeah, I remember you guys were really good. So now it makes perfect sense. You guys are pumping out NFL players over here and then going to Boston College, Big East. I mean, that's amazing. And like you said, you're a blessing, bro. You got like an amazing degree out of that. So all of this is amazing. And let me just ask you one last question about NFL before we move on to the after, because I really want to talk about everything you're doing and all this stuff. My question is, brother, what is one of the best things about NFL and being an NFL player? And what is one of the worst things about being an NFL and an NFL player?
All right. I'm going to start with the worst. Okay. So going from college was really fun because you're always with your teammates. You know, it's a team. It's guys that come out of high school and you're on a campus. You in the dorms with the dudes, you know, you're living with like eight guys. You're going to class with them, you go to eat with them. So it's a really bond, you know, you make a lot of bonds, you know, when you're going into college and you travel a lot, you know, it was really, really fun, really, really fun. You know, you don't have the stress to getting cut, you know, and getting released. You just need to go to school, have good grades and play hard on the football field. So, and then when you go to pros, the difference is everybody got a family. They got, most of them, you know, got wife, got kids. They're just going, you know, it's just a business. You know, you just go there, you do your job, and then you go back home. You know, there's a few guys that chill, but most of them, you know, they just take care of their business and then they go back home. And there's so much rollover, you know, guys getting cut every week. You know, my D-line coach, you know, he was real. He told me, he told us one day, he was like, you see guys coming in at six every Tuesday? And we're like, yeah, those guys are trying to get your spot. You know, we have scouts that having, you know, tape of them and we bring them here and we see if they can take your spot. If they take your spot, then you take the trash bag and you go out. So we're like, damn, that's real, man.
Yeah.
And my first year, I made the final cut. And one of my teammates was like, hey, bro, don't go spend too much money because you might get cut next week. You don't know. And the next day, I got the call to tell me that I was getting cut and they were putting me on the practice squad. So you can be here one day, you can be there one day. You know, so that's the worst part. The nice part is, you know, you get to play at the highest level that anybody wish they could do, you know. So since I was a kid, I remember my bedroom, I still have a picture, my bedroom was full of like NFL posters, you know. There were Ray Lewis, Randy Moss, all these guys, and I was like, damn, okay, I made it, you know, I made it there, you know, I accomplished the highest goal that I wanted. And that's why I was not sad of retiring, because I, you know, my goal was not to play 10, 20 years in the NFL. My goal was to make it there. You know, my goal was to play at the highest level that I could. When my body couldn't follow no more, I'm out.
Wow. Wow. Yeah. That is amazing, bro. That ideology of understanding the business side, of understanding the come up, which what you said is probably one of the most funnest part, the grind in itself, which is so true, bro. If you look at anybody that succeeded at such a high level towards millionaires, billionaires, actors, singers, whatever, they'll always talk about the grind of like, hey, I remember when this happened and X, Y, and Z. So if anybody that's going through that grind, you could maybe take a step back and appreciate that this is going to be a part of your hero's journey. And now we're having Mehdi kind of tell us his amazing hero's journey. And let's talk about what's next, brother. So now you're retired for a couple of years. I'm sure there was a time for you to kind of like try to figure things out, and you decided to be a real estate broker at Remax Cristal, my former office. So I'm super happy you're part of the family. So tell me how that transition happened. Why did you decide to go into brokerage? Tell me a bit about that.
You know, so when I got back from the States, I was trying to find myself, you know, because like I said, you're always surrounded by sports, and you were trying to find out, okay, what I want to do next. You know, you've been labeled a football player your whole life. Mm-hmm. So I needed to find the next step. So that's when I went to Ubisoft. I worked there for a year, and then I decided to leave because I'm an entrepreneur. I like to, you know, start my own thing and grind, you know, just grind and make it work. So I started two gym businesses. At that time, I have one that is called NGA Academy. So it's for athletes. It's for young kids. I'm trying to build a mindset to go to the next level, you know. So it's mostly we train them, but we also build a mindset to, you know, so they build confidence and they know that they can achieve great things on and off the field. And I also created Défi Santé, which is basically a kind of like CrossFit that we do, but, you know, for Monsieur et Madame Tout le Monde, so for anybody that want to get fit. So the main goal was, okay, I want to do that because I want to help people out. You know, I want to make sure that they reach their full potential. They feel good when they see me. They're happy because I help them when they, you know, sometimes they come to the gym and they're sad and then they leave. They're really happy. You know, they feel good. So I did that. Now it's been 2 years. My gym businesses are in Collège Le Tendre. Mm-hmm. I also work for Collège Le Tendre as a business developer there. So I developed the business side of thing. And last year, I met one of the broker that sold our house, and we spoke and all that, and say, hey, maybe, man, I see you doing that. You know, I see you being into real estate and helping people finding their new house, selling their house, you know, because you're relationship type of guys, you know, you like to speak with people, and I love to speak with people. And I was like, okay, let me try that. So I started my classes, and now it's been three months that I'm in the business. And, you know, I love it because it's really getting to know people. You know, people think that we're mostly doing transaction, but the way that I see myself is, you know, I'm seeing people, I'm creating connection. If it works, if we can do something in the future in 5-6 years, then yes, let's go. So that's why I'm in the business now.
That is amazing, bro. And I love one thing you really mentioned and highlighted. First of all, the fact that you have those companies that are helping out the kids, that are really teaching them how to go to the next level, because obviously you've done it and you're teaching them about the mindset part. That is beautiful. And furthermore, you said something very important, and I'm going to highlight it for our entrepreneur community over here. Business is nothing other than human connections. That's it. The more connections you make, the more relationships you build, the more you tell people what is your mission and vision, the more people will help you out with that, and vice versa. Yep. So I love that ideology, and there's no other way to succeed in real estate other than that. You have to build connections. You have to be authentic and so on and so forth. So I definitely see it within you, bro. And I'm definitely a fan, and I can't wait to see where your career is going to develop within that and how to go about this new thing, man. I'm definitely going to watch you on that. And like I said, on my end, Ned, if I could help you with anything, you know, I'm here for you, brother. Any guidance I could get within that career, bro, it'll be my honor and my pleasure, man.
Thanks, man. Thanks, Chris.
Bro, one last question before I let you go over here.
Go ahead.
If we take it back to the NFL, what is like one of the main like top superstar players that you met when you were on these two NFL teams that kind of gave you an understanding of like, oh, this is what it takes to work, or any type of advice they gave you? Because you're kind of talking about, and as you were talking about the aspect in the beginning of like, you know what, it was difficult. And then at a certain point, I didn't feel like it anymore. I couldn't help but think about the GOAT, which is Tom Brady.
Tom Brady,
which
yeah.
Last year he won the Super Bowl with your ex-team, the Tampa Bay Buccaneers. And I'm just thinking about like, what else does that man have to prove? So how do they come about and like be so present at that level and still be like, yeah, I still love it? Because if you lose that love, it's difficult. So what is one of the experiences you've had of learning from one of the best towards Tom Brady, towards anybody, whatever the case, I don't know if you cross paths with Tom Brady, but anybody, what is like one of the greatest advice you got from one of the top NFL players?
So, yeah. So when I was with the Titans, there were many guys that were trading their job, you know, pretty seriously. And they mm-hmm. were there for a few years now. You know, I'm talking about Joel Casey, Brian Orakpo, that was in the league for like 10 plus years. Derek Morgan, that played for 9. Marcus Mariota, that was our starting quarterback. You know, so when I was watching them and I was talking to them too, you know, they were always treating their body right, you know, so they did all their treatment, they ate well, they slept well, you know, they didn't do anything stupid, you know, off the field. They were not in bars, you know, drinking and partying, making scenes. So, you know, they were really serious about their thing, you know. They were coming in the building and it was business, you know. Some guys were playing dice and, you know, gambling and stuff, and they were in their playbook, you know. So they knew that when it was in the stadium, it was all about football. So they took care of their body. And when they went back home, it was also football. So they, you know, they were telling the wife, you know, I'm going to watch tape for a few hours and then I'm going to be with you guys. So, and that's something that rookies don't get. When they get in the league, they think it's going to be like college, you know, they're just going to make the minimum and they're going to have success. But you need to make, you know, the extra stuff that people don't do so you can last for a while, because if you don't, then you're going to last for 2-3 years and then you're out. So really taking everything and breaking it down and doing extra step, that's what it is.
That's amazing, bro. I love the fact that you just said, like, you know, these top end players, the top of the top, the tier of the tier, mm-hmm. take it so seriously, not only on the field, but most especially with their diet, with their sleeping patterns,
oh, yeah.
with what they're consuming, with the mindset they're consuming, with the things that they're doing within their activities. And mm-hmm. that's just the key to success everywhere. And I did see that was my last question, but I'm going to ask one last one. And sorry, bro, but I still want to be like respectful for your time here. But here's my last question, okay? Mm-hmm. And maybe it's going to be a curveball, but it's actually something that I think about, and I want to know your opinion on it as you are an ex-NFL player. Do you think the NFL and football, American football, is a dying sport? And let me explain why I'm saying that. Okay. I love the sport, super fun. It's so many great things. But more and more, as we understand how the human body is working, more and more when we seeing movies like Concussion with Will Smith, understanding how the concussions are playing, more and more when we see top end players going to their peak and being like, yo, okay, I'm done, I quit because it's too risky for my body, especially getting all through there. And now seeing statistically that there's younger players are not going as much in football and deciding to go in other avenue, other sports, because they're seeing the longevity in other sports compared to this one. Now, granted, any sport you're going to do, it's going to be rough on your body or whatever, but mm-hmm. this is next level. What is your opinion about that? Is this something you guys talk about in the locker room? Is it something you've ever thought about?
Yes. Well, we don't think that the sport is going to die, because, you know, it's still, I think, the second most popular sport in the States. You know, baseball is first and then it's football. The thing is, they need to change the rules on many things, you know. So we always talking about a summer camp. You know, summer camp is one of the hardest things that a football player can go through. Like the season is fine, but the summer camp, you're having football practice every day, you know, you weightlifting every day, you're already getting banged up like during 2-3 weeks nonstop. So that's really hard on your body, and a lot of guys get hurt at that time, you know. So so that's, I think, one thing that they should change is the way that summer camp is. And then we've seen it, they change the rule every year on stuff, so now quarterback are getting more protected during, you know, punt and kickoff. They try and change rules so guys don't, you know, getting blindsided and stuff like that. So I think that they need to change some stuff so people are not afraid to get into the sport, but they cannot do it too much, because if they do it too much, they're going to change the game. So, like, you know, sometimes we get, you know, we see a game and we see a hit and we're like, man, that's normal. And then they throw a flag. They say, ah, come on, they shouldn't go. So I think it's really hard. You know, it's a hard balance to go through. But I don't think football is going to die. I think players love to play sports, but during practice, you know, they need to be conscious of the players and taking care of their body.
That, I mean, I loved your answer, honestly. It was kind of my ideology, but I had no idea about the summer camp thing. And obviously we wouldn't, but you would, because you've lived it. So essentially just tweaking certain things, such as like the summer camp and other things, will make it that players have a more longevity life within football. So thank you for sharing that, Ned. And bro, one last thing, I just want to kind of leave the floor here for you. Tell us where we could reach you, where we could contact you, if anybody's interested in real estate, where they could hit you up in the greater region of Montreal. Kind of plug your stuff so the community can know where to reach you.
Yes, so my name is Mehdi Abdesmad. You can find me on Instagram right here or on Facebook. And if you want my number, 438-868-4532, I'm here to answer your call. Any questions, I'm here for you guys.
Let's go. Let's just specify, that's for real estate. Unless it's maybe for a girl too, I don't know. But that was mostly for real estate. Real, you know, estate. Don't like bombard the people for absolutely nothing. But if you guys want to contact him for real estate, he's the dude. Everything he mentioned will be in the comments down below. I just want to say thank you to everybody that was on the live. Great comments. Thank you for the people that are rewatching this and watching it afterwards on my YouTube channel, Christopher Dedian on YouTube. Leave the comments down below. Me and Mehdi will go answer any other questions you guys have. Mehdi, let me just say thank you, brother. What a blessing it was to have you on this show. Great show. Thank you for putting a light of positivity and seeing this amazing journey that you've lived so far, and you have so much more to go. And like I said, if there's anything I could support you with, brother, you know I'm here. You know I'm a fan.
Oh, yeah. Thank you, Chris.
All right. Have a great one, bro. Speak to you soon. Ciao, ciao.
Bye-bye.